Hi, DUUS Space here. It is well known that the Space Shuttle was originally an extremely ambitious project, a vehicle that could be easily reused after every launch, drastically reducing the costs way back in the 80s. The reality, however, kicked in, and it ended up achieving much less than it promised, with high reuse costs and safety concerns. Finally, in 2011, the rocket was retired with the landing of the shuttle Atlantis, the last mission being the delivery of supplies and equipment to the International Space Station. But even in the planning phase, the engineers knew well that reusing just the shuttle was wasteful. With every launch, the external tank and the side boosters would be discarded. This is why many innovative alternative uses of the shuttle external tank were seriously considered. Recently, while doing research, I stumbled upon an extremely interesting report on space shuttle external tank applications, published way back in 1985. It contained some fascinating propositions on how the tank could be put to good use in space, other than propelling the shuttle, and I will go through some of them today. Taking a look back at them is much more than just appreciating the past designs for a very simple reason. The core stage of SLS, the rocket being currently developed by NASA, is directly derived from the shuttle external tank, and those structural similarities imply that in theory some of the proposed applications could work with the SLS. Currently, there have been no plans to use them for different reasons. However, if the US government really plans to use this rocket design up to the year 2050, then NASA considering those projects is not outside of the realm of possibility. In its current form, the SLS is not at all sustainable, and every measure to combat that needs to be considered. So now let's dive right in and analyze the proposals. The first change to the shuttle external tank that the document outlines is the addition of the Aft Cargo Carrier, ACC for short. The tank itself, in contrast to the SLS, did not have any engines, so adding something from the lower side was a possibility. The ACC would act as a secondary payload space with an over 8-meter diameter, much larger than the 4.5-meter diameter bay of the shuttle, allowing for a large variety of payloads. Attached at the bottom of the tank, it would be flexible with its separation time. It would have also allowed for far more efficient use of the vehicle due to a simple fact. The space shuttle and its form was a bit overpowered, one could say, and while on average the bay of the shuttle was filled to above 90% of its volume, only around 66% of the mass capabilities of the vehicle were used. With every mission, a third of mass space was wasted, and adding a secondary payload could have been a solution. Inside the ACC, you could have all kinds of payloads for the use of NASA, or actually paid by both governmental or civilian parties. The proposals included such interesting payloads as catch tanks, which would gather the unused fuel and act as small fuel depots, orbital transfer vehicles, which could make use of those catch tanks, large structures like antennas, and even small space stations, which could also be sold to third parties. The idea of having small commercial space stations in orbit, which we are slowly seeing become reality, was in fact born much earlier, and the shuttle already considered realizing it. It is amazing to think what the world could have been if those plans actually succeeded. The company advocating for the inclusion of the ACC in the design was called Martin Marietta, and they calculated the total development costs for the ACC to be around $200 million, with a potential savings of $2.6 billion for NASA from a more efficient use and launch capability sales. The same company later merged with Lockheed Corporation to form the much better known today Lockheed Martin, responsible for numerous NASA and US military projects. Considering the lessons to be learned here for the SLS, it is yet to be seen if the payloads for it will actually use all of its humongous power, but I really doubt that. It is hard to justify its high price tag, and At least in theory, secondary payloads could help with that. For now, it is planned for the SLS to use its stage adapter, that you can see right now, to launch CubeSats with rideshare opportunities to deep space, which could be very exciting. It is hard to catch a ride further than the Earth's orbit, and we might see more interesting CubeSat missions. The issue is that the CubeSat market often operates on small budgets, and NASA will have to offer space on the SLS for a reasonable price to be a better option than various small sat launch providers that are emerging right now. But sadly, with an estimated price tag of over $2 billion per launch, I can't imagine the CubeSats to be even a drop in the cost. Something bigger would be needed, and although there is not a chance for anything like that on the Block 1 missions, Block 1B sparks some hope. It is designed to carry both the Orion and a module for the Lunar Gateway on the same trajectory with the huge exploration upper stage, which, fun fact, was originally called the DUUS upper stage, DUUS for short, a name which was dropped as it resembled a Japanese profanity as reported by NASA Spaceflight. There might also be some lack with Block 2 of the SLS, but it still remains to be seen. Either way, it is not likely to make much extra use of the external tank. The good thing is that there is some hope that any additional stage payloads like that would not be needed due to NASA actually using the capabilities of the SLS long term only when it really needs them. We have seen them move some elements of the Lunar Gateway, for which SLS would be a huge overkill, to the Falcon Heavy, a far more affordable spacecraft. The only question is if this decision was not made out of a realization that the Gateway could face long delays relying on the expensive SLS. But going back to the main topic of the day, the Shuttle External Tank, there were also other propositions made which could work with the SLS, as they did not concern adding anything to the tank, but rather modifying it in orbit. The ET, depending on the mission of course, separated from the orbiter around the height of 112 km and continued on with its velocity to around 209 km. A little extra push and it could have stayed in orbit for years, serving multitude of purposes. The situation here is similar with the SLS. Its core, according to NASA, will separate at an altitude of 161 km, 50 km above the one of the shuttle. How far the external tank slash SLS core could travel would of course depend on its main mission and how much fuel would be left for it. But what to do with it in orbit? Certainly we wouldn't want it to just float around as space debris. It may seem that after its use it becomes worthless, but that is very far from the truth. The report provided many different propositions on how to utilize it. The ET are basically two space-grade pressure vessels, which could be very easily transformed into storage facilities for various liquids and gases. Many of those tanks could be connected to form larger facilities. To some extent it is similar to what Nanorax is planning to do in their Outpost program, transforming a stage of a rocket in space, nowadays probably with robots. I recommend watching the video I made on the program. There have been some updates since, but it is still interesting. The difference to the program is that the ET and SLS core could fit 8 meters in diameter, giving them more uses, such as EV hangars for lunar transfer vehicles, allowing for easy construction or repairs. In this option, the external tank was to be attached as a module to a station, but in fact it was considered possible to do much more with it. Since the structure had to hold up on Earth, it was quite rigid, far more than what would be necessary for space. This is why it was proposed to be used as a strongback for the construction of new space facilities. By this, the construction costs of space stations could be greatly reduced. This particular use has become less relevant since as NASA shifted its focus to private LEO destinations, however, should not be underestimated for the future. Every time the SLS launches, the core will be wasted, so gifting it to some parties that would have use for it should not be a huge problem. Moving on, there is the next category of external tank propositions, which probably gets me excited the most. It assumed that the shuttle would be much cheaper than it ended up being, and would be used for much longer. I'm talking about space tethers. The topic and mechanics behind them are beyond exciting and deserve a future video. As you can see on the drawings from the report, the external tank could act as a counterweight for the shuttle when connected by a space tether. Such a system has many uses, but the most obvious one is creating a sort of artificial gravity, one could say, by substituting it with tension, aka so-called centripetal force. It was calculated in the report that when using a 200 meter tether and rotating it in the range of 2 to 3 RPM can create a force of 1G, effectively cancelling the negative aspects of 0G on humans. This would be perfect for long space journeys such as voyages to Mars. This is also why many envision this idea to be used by SpaceX starships traveling to the Red Planet. Many say that such solutions are only useful for long travel rather than space stations, and well, they could not be more wrong. Different rotation speeds of the system translate to different forces, which could be very useful in the in-orbit manufacturing of fragile goods. But the system doesn't even need to rotate to be useful. A space tether can form a so-called out-of-van engine, which uses the interaction between the current and the magnetic field. Long story short, if the tether is a conductor and is moving in orbit, the magnetic field of Earth or any other planetary body it is orbiting will cause charge in the tether to move, creating electricity. The same interaction can be reversed. If the electric current will be forced through the tether, it will react with the magnetic field, creating force, or rather thrust, for our system. This means that with a space tether it is possible to both give power to the vehicle or station connected to it, and also change its course slash altitude, all without any fuel other than pure electricity, eliminating the need for boosting the station with another vehicle as the ISS does. The image you see right now looks a little bit like it is from some sort of a science fiction movie, but I assure you, it is not. It is actually from Space Shuttle mission STS-75, which was researching the space tether idea. Here you also have an artistic vision of the mission. Its first part was launched in 1992 and produced mixed results. The scientists used the lessons learned for corrections to the system and reflew the mission 4 years later, this time achieving success, with observed current being 3 times as high as expected. Sadly, before it was fully deployed at 20 kilometers out of the 22 planned, the tether snapped, sending the satellite to a higher orbit than the shuttle. Nevertheless, the concept was proven. Regarding the SLS, it is not as significant right now, but once again, if NASA really will fly it up to 2050, which seems so irrational, it might as well be used with its core. The report also described some other interesting miscellaneous uses for the shuttle external tank, which were not researched as much, but had potential. They included turning the ET into a telescope, a lifeboat to be used by station astronauts to wait for help in case of emergency, and I think most intriguing of all, a space debris catcher. They of course are also really absorbing, however were not studied enough to be declared viable. If you would like to read about them, you can find the whole report in the description, along with other interesting links. The space shuttle is no longer with us, but the scientific lessons learned from its development are, and are contributing to the exploration of space. Even the plans which never became reality are of importance, such as those I presented to you today, namely adding secondary missions to the flights, repurposing rocket stages and using them in space tethers. The SLS, being derived from the shuttle, may use them in the future. Although I don't believe this is a rocket that we need, it is absolutely a rocket we will get, and all opportunities to make it better should be used. If you liked the content and are excited by the concept of planetary exploration, I highly recommend checking out my deep dive into the failure of Mars 1. Also, remember to leave a like and a subscription to the channel. This was Rivus speaking, have a great day!